Thank you. preached you are the joy of angels and of all people. Accept our incense and answer our prayers. Grant peace to the world, holiness to priests, purity to deacons, forgiveness to sinners and rest to the departed, that we may glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Gave glory to God and was fully convinced that what he had promised, he was able to do. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. For it was not for him alone that it was written that it was credited to him. It was also for us, to whom it will be credited, who believed in the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over for our transgressions, and was raised for our justification. Praise be to God always. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The evangelist Luke wrote, "Since many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as those who are eyewitnesses from the beginning and ministers of the word have handed them down to us, I too have decided, after investigating everything accurately anew, to write it down in an orderly sequence for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may realize the certainty of the teachings that you have received. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, of the priestly division of Abijah. His wife was from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both were righteous in the eyes of God, observing all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blamelessly. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced now in years. Once, when he was serving as priest in his division's turn before God, according to the practice of the priestly service, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord to burn incense. Then, when the whole assembly of the people was praying outside at the hour of the incense offering, the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right of the altar of incense. Zechariah was troubled by what he saw, and fear came upon him. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall name him John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. and he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will go before them in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of fathers towards their children, and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous, and to prepare a people fit for the Lord. Then Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." And the angel said to him in reply, "I am Gabriel, who stand before God. I was sent to speak to you and to announce to you these good tidings. But now you will be speechless and unable to speak until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which shall be fulfilled at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they were amazed that he stayed so long in the sanctuary. But when he came out, he was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He was gesturing to them, but he remained mute. Then, when his days of ministry were completed, he went home. After this time, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and she went into seclusion for 5 months, saying, "So has the Lord done for me at a time when he has seen fit to take away from me my disgrace before others." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Coming of the great and fearful day of the Lord.
This juxtaposition and overlapping of the end of the world, the coming of the Messiah, the day of judgment, and the fact that we now live in the last days, as we have had since the coming of the Messiah. And he shall turn the hearts of fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. They will form one people. They will form one entity of fidelity, of a fit people, to receive the coming of the Christ. It's the importance of this idea of the fathers turning to their children and the children to their fathers. It's the understanding of a unity of one people, of fidelity from generation to generation. In fact, quite opposite of what we're witnessing in our cultural times now, with the dissolution of family, the dissolution of generations, the dissolution of communication, so that we thought we lived in the 1970s in the me generation, but we have exponentially increased that, in which in a community we look so often to see what we get rather than what we are part of, what we work toward. So that's why part of this prophecy of Malachi, of the coming of the Christ, the great importance was the unity of the people, the unifying of them. So that when I come, that's why Malachi finishes by saying, lest I come and strike the earth with haram, utter destruction, anathema. And so it's an important fulfillment that we see to Zechariah this day. The second thing you want to note in this gospel is when the angel Gabriel appears and tells him, I am Gabriel, Gabriel, I am the strength of God, meaning the name. Gabriel is also the angel who appears to the prophet Daniel 6 centuries beforehand, who prophesies the 70 weeks of years, the 500-year period until the coming of the Christ. This is why the people around our Lord are in turmoil. That's why the concern of the coming of the Christ is a major one. There were men who presented themselves as the Christ before our Lord, and there were men who came after our Lord presenting themselves as the Christ, because they knew it had been 5 centuries since Daniel. And Daniel told us that it would be that amount of time before the coming of the Anointed One, the Messiah. And so when the angel Gabriel appears to Zechariah in the temple, this is exactly the same watcher. This is exactly the same being who had told Daniel 500 years before that Christ will come. And now he comes to fulfill by announcing to Zechariah the beginning of the unveiling, the revealing of God's plan. Now in the morning offering of the sacrifices of incense, what Zechariah is doing is the temple is divided into 2 sections. There is the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept, and other than that, the room was empty. And in front of it, between the 2 rooms, was the curtains, the drapes that were torn on our Lord's, at our Lord's death on Calvary. And the curtains were there in major part so they would be detached by the priest during the time of the tent, during the Exodus, that when they moved and the ark would be carried, they would detach the curtains, walk forward, and put the curtains over the ark so that no one would ever see it, no one ever touched it, and they picked it up with the rods that ran on either side of this box covered in gold. But in front of this curtain, and in the area where Zechariah is, it was the holy place. We have the Holy of Holies, the Kadesh Kadeshe, and we have the place Kadesh. We have the holy place. And the holy place is where each day the priest would enter. No one entered the Holy of Holies except the one high priest, and only once a year. In the holy place, the priest went in each morning and each evening. This is why St. Luke is reminding us that Zachary is one of the descendants of Aaron, one of the priestly families, and they're divided up into groups, because by this time, after 1,000 years, there's a lot of priests who are descendants of Aaron. And to this day, when you see a real estate sign and it says Abraham Cohen, if it says Cohen, C-O-H-E-N, those families are claiming to be descendants of Aaron, because Cohen means priest. So they claim to be the priestly families. But what it meant is the divisions are done up in such a way that the priests have a rotation of serving at the temple. And Zechariah probably served at a week's time, maybe twice a year. And this is one of his moments of coming in here. So he's coming in to offer the morning sacrifice. In front of the drape, there is an altar, a table, and on it are 12 loaves of bread. Lebanese bread, not Wonder Bread, right? Flat. And so there are four or three put on a row, a layer of incense, three more on top, a layer of incense, three more on top, a layer of incense. The 12 represent the presence of the tribes of Israel before the holy place of God, the Holy of Holies. It's what the candle represents in every Catholic church in front of the tabernacle. It doesn't represent our Lord. It represents us as the presence. It's why it always burns. It represents the people praying before the divine presence. And in front of that altar with the 12 breads was another altar covered in metal, which is where the incense was offered. And then off to the side was the famous menorah, which lit the area inside. And so that's what Zechariah is doing. He's doing the morning prayer service, offering incense. The people are outside singing the hymns and singing the songs. And part of the morning prayers are to ask for the coming of the Christ. Each morning Israel asks for the Messiah to come, the Redeemer, the Savior. And these prayers had special vehemence at this time because of the prophecies of Daniel. And that's why there's an ambiguity when Gabriel appears to the right of the altar and says to Zechariah, your prayers have been fulfilled. There's an ambiguity because on one thing, he seems to be responding to the coming of the Messiah, which of course he is. But also that perpetual prayer that had been in their earlier years of Zechariah and Elizabeth to have children. Now, surely at their age, we don't know how old they are, we just know that everyone knew they were way past the years of having children. That prayer which had been in their youth also seems to be being answered, because he immediately then says that your wife Elizabeth will have a son, and you will give him the name of Yohanan, John, which means God is gracious, or God gives. There are only two times in which names are given to people before their birth. The one, of course, is our Lord Jesus Christ, and John the Baptist. This whole central work of redemption in which the entire history of Israel has moved toward. The last thing I want you to know is this description that he won't drink wine, he won't drink strong drink, and razor will not touch his head. This is the Nazarite vow of the old law. Samuel was this way. His mother, when she was also sterile, had promised God, if you give me a son, I will give him to you. And he will drink no wine, he will drink no hard liquor, and the razor will never touch his head. It's the what's called the Nazarite vow of consecration. St. Paul does it at one point for a period of time. And then when he goes to the temple, he has his head shaved because of the length of his hair during that time of the vow. But others were consecrated from birth for very special purposes in Israel. And that one of them, of course, is John. And so what he's not only telling him is you're going to have a baby. That is not the main thing that the angel is telling Zechariah. He is telling that God is entrusting to you a consecrated man who will be for the joy and for the redemption of Israel in the preparation for the coming of the Messiah. So what we witness in this gospel then is picking up the story and the prophecy of Malachi from four centuries beforehand. It's the fulfillment, of course, also for Zachary and Elizabeth to at least finish their days, having given life to the world. God has done to these two individual people. For the fulfillment of this prophecy, He has made them lead their entire lives sterile. No children, no life, and carrying that burden of shame, certainly for the people of Israel, of being barren. God asked them to shoulder that cross. God asked them to suffer that during these years in order to fulfill it later on, but that doesn't change the fact that for decades, they were always going to be the priestly family that gave no priests to the continuation of the covenant. And so this power of Elias and the preparation of the messianic path we watch revealed today in this announcement to Zechariah. The last thing I want you to note is to compare the Gospels of next week and last week. Because when the angel appears to Our Lady, she also asks, word for word, pretty much the same question. How will this happen? But Zachary is struck down mute. And the Mother of God is praised. So what is the difference? They ask the same question. There is a sign given to Zechariah because he asks the question with doubt. I mean, let's face it. How many babies are you going to have if you're 78 years old? Doesn't usually happen. So in this question that he asks, there's a doubt. It's not profound. It's not infidelity. It's just kind of, how is this ever going to take place? And he is given a sign, but the sign is to be mute. Silent until the day that this child is born. That will be proof to you that what I tell you is true. And it's proof now, because the moment that you leave this temple, you will be mute. You will not be able to speak. Whereas on the side of Our Lady, when she asks the question, she's just in the quandary of how God is going to accomplish this, not from her perspective of her celibacy and her chastity, for which she doesn't see how she's going to have a child. So she is praised on the one hand, because the question that she asks of God does not carry this kind of fundamental doubt to it. But Zechariah is given a sign. God does answer his question. But it has an aspect of incredulity in it. So it is not wrong for us to ask God what He's trying to accomplish in our lives when it doesn't make sense to us. That is fine. Because what we're asking is, how is God going to accomplish this, and what does He desire me to do? That is more like the Blessed Virgin. The problem of asking the question when it is truly doubt and incredulity, this just can't possibly happen. Well, I suppose if God wants to do a miracle, it will happen. That kind of an question will always be slapped down. But to simply stand before God and say, how? I don't understand. Lead me, illuminate my heart, and guide me on the path that you desire. That question will always be praised. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Believe in one God, Father Almighty.
and with the holy kiss worthy of your blessed name,
that we may raise glory to you, to your Holy Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Give the greeting of peace to our neighbor with love and faith that are pleasing to God.
Oh, Lord,
thou all upon me.
Peace and stability of the whole world.
blessed and prosperous year for an abundant harvest, for the sick and the oppressed, for all who call upon your holy name on land, at sea, or in the air, and who profess that you are the true God, we pray to you, O Lord. And grant them their petitions. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember all the saints, the fathers, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, Mary, the Mother of God, Saint Joseph, Saint Jude, Saint Charbonne, and all the righteous and the just. Through their prayers, make us worthy to stand among them. We pray to
Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One holy Father, one holy Son, one holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our healing be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord,
my soul, so be me.
Gracious God and Father, how can we repay you for your goodness and for the salvation you have just given us? Who can give you the glory you truly deserve? In our weakness, and insofar as we are able, we worship, praise, and thank you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our God, we worship, thank and praise you. We implore your goodness and abundant mercy for the salvation of the whole world, for the protection of the living and eternal rest of the departed, for the feeding of the hungry and the support of the needy, for the visiting of the sick and the consolation of the grieving. Through your grace dwell in them, and by your abundant mercy give them life. By your cross bless your people and protect your inheritance. Adoration is due to you, to your Father, and to your Holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.